So you've been told that you need to do a research project, or a dissertation, or a thesis. Don't worry, it is not as scary as it sounds, and actually, it has a really straightforward structure that you just need to follow. And in this video, I'm going to tell you what that is. If you're new here, my name's Dr. Hayley Stainton. I've supervised hundreds, maybe even thousands of research projects. So I'm giving you my tips and advice based on my students, what they've done well, what they haven't done well over the years, so that you can put it into your own practice and get top grades. Now, the first thing that everybody is going to see when they read your research project is the title page. Now, you want this to look professional, so you probably don't want it to be covered with pictures and patterns and things like this. There might be a set format required by your tutors or your lecturers, so do just check that. But if there's not, it's generally a good idea to include the following: the title of your project, your name, the submission date, name of your tutor or supervisor, and the word count. Some people do also choose to include a small image or a logo of your college or university as well on this title page. Now, the next thing you will have is your contents page. You might want to wait until the end to do this because usually as we're working through a big project, pages will change and formats will change a little bit. So I would recommend leave this till the end, but your contents page will essentially list what all the contents of your project are. So that will include the chapters, the headings. It will also include any figures, images, etc. The next section of your research project will be your introduction. Now, I always recommend that you write your introduction last. The reason for this is because if you haven't written your project yet, you don't know what you are introducing. Now, remember, this is a big piece of work, so you won't necessarily know exactly what direction and what path your project is going to take when you first start out. When you do come to write your introduction, what you want to do here is to identify the issue or the problem, because your project is probably going to be addressing some kind of issue, and you want to gently introduce the topic. So I would recommend that you do have a few references in this, but don't overdo it. It's not a literature review. And I recommend that in this section, you really say, this is why my project is important. Your research project shouldn't be just about completing an assignment. It should be something that has real world value. So for example, if my project was about the social impacts of people who travel to Kenya, I would say in my introduction about how there have been big social impacts, rises in crime, gambling, a reduction in authenticity, globalization, etc. And I have done a video on the social impacts of tourism if you are interested to learn more about that. But I would introduce that by saying there have been all these studies in different parts of the world that say these social impacts exist, but nobody's done a study, or not many people have done a study in Kenya. That's why I'm doing it. That's why my project is important. You may also wish to include some relevant statistics, definitions perhaps, if you need to define some key terms, that kind of stuff in the introduction. Your next section then is the literature review. A literature review will often be worth somewhere in the range of 35 to 45% of your overall grade. So it's a pretty important section. And lots of people actually underestimate the literature review and they don't allow enough time. So I have talked in my video that you should check out if you haven't seen it already, all about how to do a research project plan. You need, as I say in that video, to make a good plan and allow enough time to conduct a review of the literature. That generally means reading a lot. In your literature review, you will have lots of references. There should be nothing stated in that is not supported by a reference. You cannot say there are social problems in Kenya without a reference. Google it, you'll find hundreds of references. I know that you know there are social problems in Kenya, but you can't just state that. You still need a reference because it is a literature review. It's not an opinion piece. It's not a look what I know piece. It's a literature review. I would go for as many sources as you possibly can include. Cross-referencing is a great idea. So if I said there are social impacts in Kenya, I might reference an article in the BBC, and I might reference an academic paper that was written, and I might reference a documentary that I watched about it. And that is called cross-referencing, because I'm saying lots of people have said this. It demonstrates wider reading and it will get you better grades than if you just had the one reference. Alternatively, cross-referencing can demonstrate differences in opinion. So you could say, according to this website, the social problems in Kenya are limited to Nairobi. However, according to this news report, the social problems are not limited only to Nairobi, and actually they are found all over the country. So that shows that I've done a lot of reading and I've comprehended it and I've noticed that different people are saying different things. This is what gets you the good marks in a literature review. So you want as many sources as possible and you want to demonstrate that you've understood what you're reading. You can also try to be a little bit critical of sources too. So you might say, this source says that there are social problems in Kenya. However, it was published 20 years ago, so it's a bit dated. You could say that the Kenyan government say that they are on top of the social problems and they are putting X, Y, and Z in place in order to solve these problems. However, they obviously want to promote their country and promote well-being and tourism and whatever else, so they might be a little bit biased. If you are making remarks like this, it shows you have critical thinking, it shows you've taken the source, you've read what it has to say, you've comprehended it, and then you've made your own justifications on its validity and its worthiness in terms of your project. Do these things and you will get great grades in your literature review, I promise. One other thing that you might want to do in this section is to organise your literature review into headings. So I will usually choose the key concepts. I have often taught my students over the years to do like a triangle. So you can, it's a bit more of a diamond, wasn't it? A triangle. So you can actually say three, I mean, you might want more, you might want less, but as a rough guide, maybe three main concepts. So if I was doing a project on the social problems in Kenya, in my literature review, I might have one concept that would be social problems around the world. I might have one main section that would be about development in Kenya, growth in Kenya, and I might then have a section on case study based facts, what are the social problems that are identifiable in Kenya. So you break it up into the key concepts. The next section of your research project is the methodology. Now this is also a very important section. If your methodology is weak, then your whole project is going to be weak. You need to demonstrate that you've thought about it, that you know what you're talking about, that you know why you're doing what you're doing. So in this section, I recommend that you explain what methodology you're going to use. You then need to justify that and explain why you're doing questionnaires for this. And when you do this, back it up with lots and lots of references. You cannot just say, I'm going to do questionnaires. Well, you can, but you won't get a good grade. You want to say, I'm going to do questionnaires. I'm going to use this type of question. So for example, open questions or closed questions or scale questions. A questionnaire is good because, and look at the research methods literature. So you should, within this section, consult several texts. And there are lots of books, sort of introduction to research methods types books that are super helpful. But you must reference them in order to get the good grades. So don't just say I'm doing questionnaires, say I'm doing questionnaires, this is what they're gonna look like, this is why I'm doing it, these are the negative things about it, but I'm going to overcome that, or I don't see that as a big enough issue, because with lots of references scattered all the way through. In your methodology, you will also want to discuss whether you're doing qualitative or quantitative work, and why, with lots of references. And you will probably want to talk a little bit about your research approach, your research philosophy, depending on the level of your project. If you are sort of doing a BTEC qualification or A-levels, you probably don't need to go into that depth. But if you are doing a degree level or higher, then I recommend you do. And I have a great video all about that. You can click on that now on the Research Onion, which breaks that down really well into a really simple way of including that section of your methodology. You will also want to talk about sampling. So your sample is the respondents that you're going to be consulting. So the people that you give your survey to, or the people that you interview. Who are they? Why have you chosen those people? And most importantly, what type of sample is it? Again, take a look at those research methods books. You will have lots of different types of samples. So a popular one, for example, is snowball sampling. So I could give my questionnaire to you and I say, would you give it to your friends as well? So that's an example of a snowball. Do not, a lot of students make this mistake, do not think that a random sample is just giving it to whoever you see on the street. That's not random. Those people walk down the street, they're the people you've given it to. They're not random. They're the people who've walked down the street. A random sample is one that is entirely random. So for example, if you are interviewing tourists to Kenya, if it was a true random sample, you would need to have equal chance of selecting any tourist who's been to Kenya. Now, in most cases, this is not achievable. So in most cases, you will not be using a random sample. In many cases, it will be a purposive sample, which is one where you have chosen that for a reason, because those people are accessible to you, or because those people are, mainly because they're accessible to you. I won't go into too much detail about sampling right now, but it is an important part, and you need references. Reference, 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 or you won't get the top marks. And when it comes to your specific research method, so for example, an interview or a survey, you need to also detail exactly what that's going to look like and how you're going to do that. So if I'm doing interviews, I need to say, is it a structured interview or a semi-structured? What are the benefits and the limitations of that? Why have I decided that's best for my project? And I need to have lots of references scattered all the way through. So if you are feeling a bit overwhelmed, please don't worry. I'm just going through a whole research project with you at super fast speed. I will break all of this down in future videos, don't worry. If you are finding this helpful so far though, please do give this video a like. It helps YouTube to share it with other people just like you, which makes me happy. Okay, so the next section is your results and your analysis. Sometimes you will have a results section or chapter, and then a separate analysis chapter. Now, of course, check if your institution has specific guidance. If they don't, then you are free to make that decision yourself. Oftentimes, people who do quantitative data, so they will get numbers. So, for example, if you hand out a survey and you've got you use closed questions, you are going to get numbers. How many people said yes and how many people said no? Many times, people who have that kind of data will choose to have a separate results chapter where they have tables, graphs, whatever's appropriate. Then they will talk about it in the next chapter, which will be analysis. Oftentimes, if you are doing qualitative research, that's not so easy because you will be using quotes for your evidence because you haven't got any hard numbers. So you might say, for example, tourists who visit Kenya sometimes feel scared for their safety. Now, you're not just going to put that there and that's it for your chapter. You want to then talk about it. So many people who do qualitative research will often combine the results and the analysis chapter into one. And that's perfectly acceptable in most circumstances. The most important thing you want to do here is to demonstrate your results and then be critical of them. So don't just say 10 people said yes and 5 people said no. Can you compare that to another question? So 10 people who said yes in this question also said yes in that question. So that means these people are likely to answer this way. So for example, you might have a question, do you have friends and relatives who live in Kenya? And people answer yes or no. And then you might have another question, do you feel safe when traveling in Kenya? And you might find that actually when you run a test, and I'm not gonna go into the details of statistical tests right now, but you might do a test and you might find actually people who have friends and relatives in Kenya tend to feel safer when they visit Kenya. So that's you demonstrating, yes, I haven't just taken the numbers from each individual question, but I've also combined questions and I've then analysed that. And then you will generally have a discussion chapter, which could be combined in with your results and your analysis if you wish. And that's when you're really going to discuss it and to link it all in with the literature. You then want to talk about that in regards to the literature. So in my research, I can see that people who have friends and relatives who live in Kenya are less likely to feel unsafe when they are in Kenya. This supports the research that was undertaken by whoever that I referred to in my literature review. So you're bringing, in this chapter, the idea is to bring all of the project together. That literature review needs to feed in to the analysis. Get those references back in. The literature review isn't something you just do and just leave it to sit there. It all needs to come together. It's one big project and it needs to come together. So in this chapter, you want to be really critical, really analytical. Say, if there's a weakness in your results, talk about it, don't hide it. And the more critical you are, the higher your marks will be. This section is normally worth quite a few points, so don't leave it till the last minute. Don't rush it. It's an important part of your research project. Then in your conclusion, you want to finalize what you've done. Summarize. This is what the project's about. This is what's happened. This is what I have found. This is my conclusion. And in that section, you want to make recommendations for further research as well. You can say, my research is great, but I think we need more in this area or that area. In this section, say who your research is good for. My research is really great for tourism businesses who want to start up business in Kenya, because now they have a better idea about the social impacts and what tourists think about it, or whatever is appropriate. In this section, link back to those aims and objectives, link back to your introduction, say what you achieved, so that it should be almost like a full circle. At the beginning of your project, you said, this is what I'm gonna do, this is why it's important, and at the end of your project, you need to say, this is what I did, and this is why it was important. It should go full circle. And the last thing that you will need to do is to put in any recommendations. So, based on my research, I recommend there should be further research. Based on my findings, I recommend tourism businesses should act differently, or whatever is relevant for your study. Now, once you've finished the bulk of your research, there are a couple of things that will usually go at the end of your project. This is an appendix. So an appendix is a section that has anything extra. So if you want to, you can include a copy of your questionnaire here, or your survey, or your interview script. You can include any tables or images, etc., that you think are important, but you didn't want to include in the main body. Anything else like that. And then you want to have a very long, comprehensive reference list. Make sure your references are done perfectly, in alphabetical order, according to the reference system that you are supposed to be using, etc. And if there were any sources that you did read and you found were helpful, but you didn't directly cite them in your research project, then you can include them at the end in a bibliography. I tend to like this. I just think it demonstrates wider reading, demonstrates a knowledge and that you've done lots of work. And you're never going to be penalized for listing too many sources. So if you do look at any books, I recommend just sticking them in there at the back. So I hope I haven't confused you. I hope that was clear and simple. And you've got a really quick overview of what needs to come where in your research project. Now, I will be making lots more videos where I talk about each individual section in more detail. So do stay tuned for that. And if you're not subscribed already, make sure you subscribe to my channel. Good luck with your project. Let me know how it goes and have a great day.